This week on Maker Update, killing bugs from your secret bunker, over-center mechanisms, puzzle games for cats, and if you give a cockroach a burger. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we do things not because they're easy, but because we thought they were going to be easy. I'm Tyler Weingartner, and I hope you're all doing great. We've got a wonderful show for you, so let's check out the project of the week. It's always interesting to learn what motivates people to tackle big projects. Maybe it's just a desire to see the thing out in the world, or maybe you were challenged by someone else, or you just want to make something work better. Basically, Homeless was recently inspired by something else to build this robot, his irrational fear of wasps. He's also an avid FPS gamer. So the whole point of this robot is allow him to play a real-life first-person shooter game where he hunts his mortal foe. But the idea and concept is so much easier than the execution in reality. You could use a three-axis gimbal to capture the 360-degree panning and tilting motion of a first-person shooter game, but they're relatively slow compared to the flick of a mouse. And there just isn't a commercial gimbal that's capable of handling his payload of two cameras and the trigger mechanism for the airsoft gun. Oh yeah, this thing has a remotely triggered airsoft gun. It has to be an airsoft gun, because if it were a real firearm, it would violate just about every gun law there is. But an airsoft gun is still powerful enough to harm the wasps. To get the payload moving at Twitch gaming speeds, he's building a custom pan tilt setup with high-speed motors. And the whole thing is mounted to a wheeled robotics platform with four mechanum wheels so it can move around. To make sure he can see what the cameras can see from a remote location, he needs high-speed, low-latency video encoding and streaming, which is why he's built a small form factor computer on the platform as well, handling video encoding from both of the cameras. And to power everything, he's using one of those 110-volt AC battery packs. This setup is nuts, and his struggles were real, but he manages to pull it off. What's even wilder is that he barely wrote any code for it. Most of the code was actually created by ChatGPT. And the fact that a project this complex was created with code written by a large language model is a pretty startling testament. It's hard to tell how effective it is at wasp killing, and he's not even sure if he got a confirmed kill. But it's an impressive endeavor all the same. More projects. I didn't intend for this to be a bug-themed show, but you have to check out this super-sized SpongeBob meme by Emily the Engineer. She was asked to build a prop for Nickelodeon's Kids' Choice Awards, and she decided to make this cockroach munching on a burger at the Krabby Patty. And for maximum selfie potential, she made it 6 feet tall. That way folks could sit at the table with it and have their memorable moment. The whole body is 3D printed, and it's awesome to see how it was all printed in parts that were then joined together. These pieces almost look like they were the entire build volume of your 3D printers. But before any of the bug parts could be printed, Nickelodeon also wanted her to make 200 of her magic conch shells that could be used as invitations to the event. It was a massive undertaking, but hearing them react to seeing this thing take shape in her studio is just infectious.
He's real!
Gore!
If this doesn't make you want to build something huge and ridiculous, I don't know what will. And of course, it was a huge hit at the event. Peter Brown has a video about his refined process of making resin stained glass. His process begins by laser cutting the stained glass panels from thin plywood. He then shows two different methods for making the wood look like copper. The easy method is just to spray paint it with a copper colored paint. But the more involved method is actual copper plating using an electroplating process. This gives them a more satisfying feel and actual heft. And the copper will develop a patina over time. You also get to see the rest of his process for taping, pouring and mixing the resin. It's a great video. And we have a new project video from Maker's Muse, where Angus has built this puzzle box for his two cats. He's built a few puzzle boxes for other animals, and since he's new to cat ownership, he's really curious to use this to understand how cats think and solve problems. There are a few pegs that need to be removed to release the tasty treats, and he's really enjoyed watching them figure it out in a bunch of different ways. What's more, they love playing with it so much that he has to hide it from them so they can't find it when he doesn't have it set up for active play. He's got all the files available to his community, but it's probably not too tough to make it on your own. Time for some tips and tools. Stefan from CNC Kitchen just released this fantastic primer video about flexible filaments, TPU and TPE. These filaments are confusing and notoriously difficult to work with. There's a ton of different compounds, hardnesses, and getting them to print successfully is a lot like pushing a rope. Stefan discusses all their different properties using a series of tests and how to adjust some of those properties by altering the infill ratio. But the most important part of the video, especially folks who are new to flexible filaments, is how to succeed with printing. Check it out. This Old Tony has a video that's about a month old about over-center mechanisms. These are mechanisms you've encountered in hundreds of applications. Latches, switches, even salad dressing lids. Any mechanism that can be changed from one position to another, and it will stay there on its own. He shows a few examples using springs, but eventually gets into the meat of designing mechanisms like toggle clamps. Tony is an engaging teacher, and it's great to have a better understanding of how these mechanisms work. Speaking of making your own tools, Alexandre Chappel has a great video about 3D printing your own tools. You might not think you can get much out of brittle plastic tools, but he has a bunch of examples of jigs, marking rulers, gauges, guides, and more. I love his use of multi-material printing to make these precision rulers. And since one color is used just on the first layer, you can make these on a single material printer. Lots of great stuff in here. Don't miss it. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, Becky Stern's latest video is a handy guide on how to decide what microcontroller to use in your project. If you're new to all this, it's easy to think it's all Arduino, and for a lot of simple projects, that's going to carry you for a long time. But these days, we're really spoiled with the amount of choice we have. 32-bit processing, SoCs with Wi-Fi capability, number of pins, compatibility with MakeCode or CircuitPython. Becky breaks down what all of these terms mean and offers some examples from her own projects about why she went with the board that she did. It's good stuff. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. Remember that you can get more info about every single one of these projects by checking out the links down in the description. And while you're there, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next one. As always, great big thanks to DigiKey for making this show possible and you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.